Testament book of Judges. Beginning with verse number 12, reading through verse number 16. Sixth chapter of Judges. Sixth chapter of Judges 12 through the 16th book. Shall we stand for the reading? Let's read together, please. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto Gideon and said unto him, The Lord is with thee, thou mighty man of valor. And Gideon said unto him, O my Lord, if the Lord be with us, then why is all this happening? And where be all these miracles which our fathers told us of, saying, Did not the Lord bring us up from Egypt? But now the Lord has forsaken us, and delivered us into the hands of the Midianites. And the Lord looked upon him and said, Glory in this thy might, and thou shalt save Israel from the hands of the Midianites. I have not sent thee. Then he said unto him, O my Lord, wherewith shall I send Israel? Before my family is poor and mess up, and I am the least of my father's house. And the Lord said unto him, Surely I will be with thee. Thank you for your obedience. You may be seated. I want to speak to us on a message entitled, God Will Fight Your Battle. God will fight your battle. God will fight your battle. You notice the Gideon, how can I do that? The least of the tribe of the Manasseh, not the greatest one of my father's house. God doesn't entertain that much. God say, I'm with you. I'm with you. The book of Judges explains why Israel suffered from their enemies. The book of Judges tell us and explain to us, share with us, why Israel suffered at the hands of their enemies. The fault was Israel's sin. Israel suffered because of its sin, not because of God's unfaithfulness. We want to establish that in the beginning. Israel's problem was the result of Israel's sin. God is always faithful. And if we trust him, if we do what he said, if we follow his plan for our lives, and the pattern that he has given us for living our lives, also for raising our children, and for establishing our relationship, we have some problem, yeah, but we will always sense God's presence in our conflict. And we don't have to deal with it alone. Listen, the book of Judges shows us the sovereignty of God, that God rules. It shows us this in two ways. First of all, when Israel sinned, and when Israel sinned had become of such magnitude, God sent foreign nation soldiers to come in and capture them. But when they repented, and after the time of their discipline was completed, then God raised up deliverers that they might deliver Israel from the hand of their enemy. Because it's consistent in his ways. We may find ourselves in trouble. We may find the way of life difficult because of choices and decisions that we make. But when we turn to him, confess our sins and acknowledge our wrong to God, God will deliver us. He will deliver. And God delivers on time. God has a due season. You see, whenever God chastises, he has a beginning point and he has an ending point. You can prolong your day of chastisement by hardening your heart and insisting on doing it your way, or I can insist on doing it my way. But when we surrender and acknowledge to God, it's not my mother, my father, my sister, brother, husband, wife. I'm the one who made the decision to walk away. I'm the one who made the decision to relax my prayer life. I'm the one who made the decision to follow this group instead of the heavenly group. Listen. God said, deliver us so that Israel could be saved from their oppressors. The book of Joshua shows what happened to Israel when there was no godly king to lead them. And when there is no godly leader, a nation declines. When there is no godly leader, families decline. When there are no godly leaders in the home, churches decline. When there are no godly pastors, churches decline. You say, well, I see a whole lot of them. God does not, and you'll see it later, God is not concerned about numbers. God doesn't need a whole lot of folks to get his work done. When there is no godly leader, individuals decline. If you want your life to decline, exclude God out of your program. When there is no godly leader. And we need to hurry up and understand that, because we are so captivated by appearances and attractiveness. And so then we go after things that look good. Our mind is predicated on what look good. Our selection of a mate is predicated on what look good. And God is saying, don't invest all of your time, effort, and desire into attractiveness. You need to look beyond what you can see with the naked eye and consider what is behind the attractiveness. We call it character. So then Israel declined, Israel downfall. What led to Israel's downfall in the time of the judges? What was it? First of all, I submit unto you, Israel ran into trouble because of incomplete obedience. Incomplete obedience. Not total disobedience, but incomplete obedience. You see, when God told Israel, when you go into the land of Canaan, I want you to wipe out the Canaanites. I want you to wipe out men, women, and children. I want everything about Canaan to be destroyed. Because God knew that Israel allowed a remnant that sooner or later, the Canaanites and their way of life, their gods, the gods that they served, would sooner or later usurp Israel and bring Israel over to its side. We see that happening today when the church is sent to go out into the world and change the world. We witness now much of the church, much of the world has come into the church. And we establish our value system on appearance and attractiveness. If it look good, if it look good, then it got to be all right. If that folk hanging off the balcony, over the balcony, the Lord is moving. Just because the church have a lot of folks in it, it doesn't mean that the folks have a lot of church in it. It's not about church clothes. It's not about church liturgy, practices. It's about heart being committed to Almighty God. So Israel fell because of incomplete obedience. They failed to drive out the Canaanites completely. You got to drive out the Canaanites completely. You got to drive out the Canaanites completely. Not just halfway. Not just some adjustment to my life. But yet at certain times I go back to the same practices. You got to drive the Canaanite out completely. Yeah, the Canaanite, that telephone number. You got to drive it out completely. We still can be friends. You got to drive the Canaanite out completely. I thank God for the reputation to be able to preach in a way folk can understand. And then what else brought about was idolatrous worship. You see, they went in, did not drive the Canaanites out completely. Canaanites continued to worship that God, and sooner or later, Israel began to become acclimated and assimilated into the Canaanite worship. Canaanite worship. You got to write the Canaanite. Canaanite. You don't write the Canaanite, you find yourself worshiping the Canaanite God. If you don't write the Canaanite, you'll find yourself going to the Canaanite places. You'll find yourself breaking the same thing, the Canaanite God. For watching the conversation, you'll find yourself talking Canaanite talk on the telephone. You know, imagine that. Yeah, we thank God our children graduating, thank God for wedding reception and so forth. But if you don't watch it, it kind of like a slip in to your graduation celebration. Am I helping somebody? Yeah, and then that was intermarried. They intermarried. They lived like married the Canaanite women. Now, this was a sin not because of any racial superiority that Israel had over Canaan, but because they worshiped, they married these women, and the God of the Canaanite became the God of these Israelites. So then, the Midianites, along with other Eastern people, have oppressed Israel for 7 years. The Spirit of the Lord came upon Gideon, and he prepared for the battle against the Midianites. Gideon devised a test. You need to be sure that God told you to do what you say he told you to do. And Gideon said, well, Lord, I understand that the angel is saying that, and you calling me to be a deliverer of the Israelites from the Midianites. But I want to be certain of this. I don't want to go out in your name and you did the same thing. I don't want to go out claiming that I'm in compliance with the great God of heaven when you don't have anything to do. Now, Gideon understood that if he followed his own path and sprinkle some godliness over him, he understood that whatever he went into, whatever battle he fought, whatever undertaking he did, he would be a failure if God was not in it. You better make sure God told you the same. You better make sure God told you to preach. You better make sure God told you to chat here. You better make sure that God told you to feather that gap. And you better be sure that God told you to direct this. You better be sure that God told you. I don't have to be sure. But you need to be sure. I have to be sure of myself. Am I helping somebody? I see some young folks in here. Let me say this and kind of help you out. So maybe you thought about it already. I don't know. But you better be sure. God told you to give that little boy your number. You better be sure God told you to get in the car with that girl. You better be sure. Am I helping somebody? You better be sure. Don't be influenced by marital statistics that show females outnumber blacks, and you better not get so desperate that you have to lie wrong to death anybody. Because you might not get another chance. See, you can easily get something for yourself. And then you need the whole world to help you tell you. Gideon said, I need to know for sure that you sent me and you are sending me. I want to divide the test. I said, okay, go on. Gideon said, I'm going to take a fleece and I'm going to put it on the floor. And when I wake up, I want to see that the fleece is wet, but all around the fleece, the floor is dry. That happened. Gideon, he wanted to be mighty sure. Gideon said, okay, fine, that's okay. But I asked you again, Lord, to submit you another test. He said, and I'm going to put the fleece out, and this time, I want the fleece to be dry. But all around, I want the floor wet. In other words, God confirmed to Gideon that he was sending him out. Gideon wanted to be sure, after being convinced that the Lord was with him, Gideon blew a trumpet, and when he blew a trumpet, 32,000 came from all different prophets to join in the battle. Be ready to fight with Gideon. Gideon, good, ready. 32,000, a million, a 15,000. I feel good now. We outnumbered him. Gideon felt confident that he had enough soldiers. And look what happened. The Lord said to Gideon, good Gideon, you got 32,000. Yeah, I can see. Things looking good for you, right? But I got a surprise for you, Gideon. I want you to reduce. I want you to reduce your number. Am I right? I want you to reduce your number. That those who are afraid, they are dressed up like soldiers. They got weapons in their hands. But Gideon, you looking at that posture, you looking at how they salute, and you looking at how they march, and you look at how they hold that bayonet. But Gideon, I'm looking at their heart. Soldiers, they look like soldiers, they eat like soldiers, they march like soldiers, but Gideon, I'm looking at their heart. In other words, Gideon did not miss something. When Gideon gives the call of text, 22 went back. Gideon said, well, 22 left, I still got 10,000. That's not too bad. I guess I can make it with 10. And the Lord said, Gideon, guess what? I got no surprise for you. All of these, you see what God said, and you read it, God said that I can't allow too many to go into battle because of the fact that if too many soldiers are involved in this victory, y'all gonna thank the Lord. And so y'all might know that y'all didn't do it. He said, I want you to give, you are submitted to your test. Now I want you to submit to my test. I want you to bring them down by the river. And I want you to give them the lap test, the lick test, the water test. And when you went through with that, But God wanted them to understand that he can fight our battles, no matter how many. You see, there are times when we are outnumbered. On the job, we might be the only three. Sometimes we are outnumbered. In our family gathering, we might be the only one with the Bible, the only one who said, let us begin this family gathering with a prayer. We might be outnumbered. We might be outnumbered in the family gathering. But remember, if you commit your will to God, And if you surrender to him, God can make your work prosper. You don't have to take a back seat because the rest of the family and the rest of the group fail to acknowledge God. God can make your work prosperous. God reduced Gideon's army because he didn't want the people to think that the victory was going to their ingenuity. You see, everybody who showed up at the well of hell was not ready for battle. And so 9,700 went back. We must search our hearts to know if we are spiritually ready for battle. We have to search our hearts. A lot of times, positions look attractive. And sometimes you are enticed by other people. You can do it. I got confidence in you. And that may be true. But you need to search your own heart and know if you're willing to engage in whatever battle that is involved in going, that is involved in doing that particular task. Don't do it because it's glamorous. Don't let other folks push you into a position that you're not certain in your heart that God has placed you. You have not put yourself to the test. And you are convinced that this is what God will have you to do. We must search our hearts to know if we're ready for the spiritual battle. We must search our hearts to know if we're ready to fight against all that dishonors God.
Yes.
Are we ready to live holy and righteous lives? Are we ready to deny ourselves from all ungodliness? Are we ready to separate ourselves from all unchristian, unholy, unheavenly, unspiritual practices? Are we ready to separate ourselves from every appearance of evil? God reduced Gideon's army because he wanted the glory. And he would not share his glory with anyone. God wanted the glory. And God wants the glory for building his church into a fellowship of love. God wants the glory to build his church into a fellowship of forgetfulness. Y'all listen to me. I'm talking about this church. God wants the glory in building his fellowship into a fellowship of love. He wants the glory for building this fellowship in such a way that when we come together, we can feel his presence. We can, our service, our worship can be inspired by him. And it's no longer our talent, but it now is our gift. And we want God to breathe upon whatever we do, whether it's singing and preaching, playing or praying, whatever we're doing, we want God to breathe on it. And to lift it to the throne, it's human production, and make it a spiritual thing. Where our hearts are touched, and minds are touched, and hearts are changed, and reconciliation is brought about. God wants the glory. He wants to anoint us. God wants the glory for inspiring us to victorious lives. He wants the glory for inspiring us to seek his favor and his forgiveness. He wants the glory. Yeah. Listen to me. God wants the glory. He wants us to stand firm on his promise. God wants the glory for being present with us, delivering us from bad habits, from fleshly indulgence, from abusive relationship. God wants the glory. God wants somebody to tell how we delivered them from drugs and from alcohol and from bad relationship. God wants the glory. I want the glory. He wants us to testify. And you hear preachers say sometimes, if God had done anything for you, you ought to wave your hand. If God had done anything for you, you ought to stand on your feet at times. If God had done anything for you, your object and to jet into your lunch break at work. How the Lord has been good to you. You don't have to go and tell a whole, take up the whole lunch break with your testimony, but God is good. That's sometimes insufficient. God help me out. That's sufficient. I wouldn't know how I would have made it. I don't know how I would have made it had it not been for God on my side. Somebody ought to testify. You're not waiting to hold your testimony until you come to the house of God. You ought to testify where you are. When you pray for your items, you ought to just tell the cashier, God bless you. God loves you. God cares for you. Thank God. I'm not helping somebody. You ought to have it in your heart to speak a word for the Lord. It doesn't take all day. It doesn't take a whole book. You're telling somebody about the goodness of the Lord. Listen, God does not need, he reduced them, get the alarming. God does not need a large group, a whole lot of people. God does not need elaborate systems for sophisticated techniques and methods. God needs people who are going to trust him. Success is not dependent on numbers. Sometimes failure, I guess, is the third time. Sometimes failure is the result of having too many. Sometimes we fail because we have too many. I identify too many folks who are not committed. Too many folks who are not dedicated. Too many folks who don't have the program of God at heart. Too many folks who are in it for themselves. Sometimes I'm trying to get to the altar to thank God for how good he's been to me. I have too many folks who just standing in the way like Gideon. And now I'm going to get to the altar to confess my sin and say to God, clean me and wash me. And somebody's standing in the way. I'm on my way to the altar trying to get this thing right with God, and somebody tapping me on the shoulder won't hold a conversation, and somebody tapping me on my shoulder and trying to point to somebody else. In the way, God said to get him, come up on my dust in the way. Get him out of the way. Got too many folks in the way. God says, yes. Listen. The power of God is far more important than any human agency. We make too much out of our planting and watering, and not enough of God who alone can give the increase. Do too much research. We preachers, we do too much research, too much theological speculation, and not enough depending on the Holy Spirit. My heavens tonight, I submit unto us the early church preaching gospel in this power and turn the Greco-Roman world upside down, not because they had so many sinners, but because they knew Jesus. Listen, don't make a mistake in your ministry sometime in devising your own plan. Sometimes our plan hinders God's intention. Let me say this, the quality of human agency is more important than the size of this plan. It has been well said, listen to this, it has been well said, that it would be better for the cause of Christianity in the world if there were fewer Christians. It's been said that it would be better. Now listen. It's been said that it would be better for the cause of Christianity in the world if there were fewer Christians and better ones. This is a way of trying to emphasize out there. We don't need more Christians, we just need better Christians. Spirit-filled Christian. Spirit-led Christian. The great want of the church is not more liberals, but better ones. Better ministers. Better missionaries. Better teachers. Not more sound, but more able preachers. We have a whole lot of stuff. Everything will be fine. But we need more able preaching. That is give evidence of God. And so then, as I come to a close here, we God needs more people who are willing to trust him, no matter the circumstances. More people who believe that he will do just what he said he will. God needs more people. Get in the community. I need more soldiers who believe in my love, my power, and who believe in my commitment. God needs more people who can lean, who don't lean to their own understanding, but lean to his precepts. People who say, I know my situation, but not singing faith. People who say that I know my resources are limited and I'm up against insurmountable odds. But if God be for me, doesn't matter who is against me. More people who say what God did yesterday, what one or two, he can do it. Who say, in spite of what this worldly system offers, my daughter, my son, if I train them up in the way that they should go, they'll be able to fight against and withstand the pressure of this evil society. God needs more folks who believe his word. Yes, God needs more people who are going to hold on. I know, Lord, it will make me seem like an outcast, Lord. I know that I'm struggling for my job. I know that I'm struggling with my children. I know that things are hard, times are hard. And I know that there's a formidable foe against me. But I believe that all things are working together for good. I believe, I still believe, I might be down, but I still believe I'm more than a conqueror. I still believe that you are on my side. I believe that you can take care of my problem. I believe that you can make a way out of no way. I believe that you can open doors when man told them. I believe that you can close doors. I believe. Like my life was like dry bones in the valley, but I believe that you can speak. And your word can bring the bones of my bring them back together. I believe that there are more folks who are trusting in him and not in numbers. I believe that you can take away my drug problem. I believe that you can take away my selfish spirit. It dawned on me the other day, grandmother set things in motion. And I reflect Ella Roberts. When I dated that new cousin, your uncle, Sam Parker, Sister Daisy Bone and the others, I remember them saying the old church, ain't nothing. They saying nothing, isn't anything. They saying nothing. Too hard for God to do. Heard the old grandfather's voice was loud and strong when he sung, Jesus is on a man's line. Tell him what you want. And he said, what you mean tell him what you want? He said, if you want salvation, tell him what you want. He said, if you want your body healed, tell him what you want. Then he says you want the Holy Ghost.
Heaven!
What you want.
All in love, baby, tell me what you want. Amen. God bless you all again. And the Lord.